All right, thanks everybody for coming out this morning. I'm going to talk about some issues with the police department, police chief search, and how we're going about all that. So I think all of us recognize how important it is for police officers to be an active part of the communities they serve. When Reverend Jesse Jackson came to our city here this last weekend, it was a point that he mentioned frequently. The importance of police getting out of their cars, talking with residents, interacting are all super essential parts of being a police officer. And that's just one example of the kind of work that I'm talking about when I stress the need for increased trust and in the community and police community legitimacy. Because it's clear that if people don't have trust and confidence in the police as a whole, and if they don't believe officers are honest and competent, and they treat people fairly and with respect, the police are not seen as legitimate. So the community is the group that makes that determination. LMPD recognizes that. That's this concern over ethical policing and police community legitimacy are reasons why, amongst the reasons why we're hearing the protests in our streets here in Louisville and streets in over 150 different cities across the nation. The community wants better and the police want better as well. So the question is, how do we move forward as a city? How do we move forward as a country? First, we need to take a hard look at the policies and how they're applied. Think about the procedures, the structures of our police department to ensure that they align with the goals and values of our community. That's why the process to contract an outside firm to do a comprehensive top-to-bottom review of LMPD is already underway, the process. The process will include substantial input from the community because it's absolutely essential that the people of Louisville are involved in this review. Regarding the timeline, we've extended the request for proposals to June 16th to maximize the opportunity for potential vendors to participate and to be evaluated. This top-to-bottom review aligns with what's called the Sentinel Event Review, in other words, a review of just one major event. In this case, it's the Breonna Taylor case. This project is a joint project of the National Institute of Justice and the Pacific Institute for Research. I announced this review on May the 29th, and it is meant to identify underlying factors, mistakes, opportunities for improvement, etc., and critical incidents like this, with the goal of improving the criminal justice system and, again, building police community trust and legitimacy so people can understand exactly what happened and how we can improve. The search for a new LMPD chief is another opportunity, and I want to talk more about that today. The search is being led by the Police Executive Research Forum, also known as PERF. They're a nonprofit Washington, D.C. based police research organization that's very well known here in America and around the world. PERF has identified best practices for cities across the country on fundamental issues such as reducing police use of force, developing community policing and problem-oriented policing, using technology to deliver police services to the community, and evaluating crime reduction strategies. One of the main directives that we gave to PERF is that the community must be involved in the search for a new chief. So today we're announcing the launch of a community survey to get started. We want to hear your priorities for the next police chief. We're asking you, our citizens, to share the three most important qualities or skills you would like to see in the next police chief, your suggestions for improving police services, and what you think the new chief needs to accomplish immediately and over the next 2 to 3 years. At the same time, we will be surveying LMPD employees by asking similar questions. The input of both the public and the police department are obviously important to make sure we get this right. All right, sorry about that. When you think about what's some of the requirements for the new chief, the chief has to be able to communicate effectively and build trust with the community, and the chief has to have those same skills within LMPD as well. The community survey will be up for at least 3 weeks and can be accessed at https://arcg.is/18ftns, and you all have that information in your press release, so please share that on your crawlers with the TV stations. We're working to set up a phone line for those without access to computer. In terms of the internal distribution of the survey, the LMPD survey will be coming from Chief Rob Schroeder's email. The council and I are encouraging everyone to participate, especially those who have been marching and protesting, and those who support them, which is the vast, vast majority of the community. We absolutely need to hear from you. In addition to this, over the next month or so, PERF will hold listening sessions with various groups from across the community. We'll be reaching out to council for their input on who should be part of those sessions. After that, PERF will review and analyze all the information that our citizens have provided in the surveys and listening sessions to help pinpoint the qualities and characteristics we need for our new police chief. And then we'll use that information to conduct a national search and create a list of qualified candidates. Next steps include convening a small group of the community and Louisville Metro representatives, again with council input, to review the list, narrow it, conduct interviews, and send me their final recommendations. The entire process is expected to take 4 to 6 months. We want all of our citizens to be engaged in the process because it's going to take all of us to get this right. People need to be heard and included in the process. I want the whole community to feel like, okay, this is our new police chief. When we step back for a moment, our city and our country are in agreement that this is a special moment in time, not just for Louisville, but for all of America. And it's a time to face our history and rethink many of the structures that have produced much of the pain that we're seeing here in Louisville and around the country. And that's why, despite all the turmoil and pain we've experienced in Louisville and in cities and towns around America, that I remain very hopeful. This type of outcry and the attention it is receiving, especially from white America and white Louisville, is long, long overdue. And change is possible, and transformation is possible. We must make it happen, and I am committed with every fiber in my body, in my mind, to make it happen as well. Now, as I noted, our Metro Council will be an important part of the process of seeking a new police chief, and Council President David James is here to talk about that. President James?
Thank you, Mayor Fisher. First, I'd like to thank the mayor for announcing the process for finding a new police chief for our community. I think it's very, very important that our entire community take part in this activity. That's why the mayor also talked about having a phone number for people to be able to call that don't have access to the internet. And the public input process is extremely important. But I would also say that I think it's important that the public get to meet the last final candidates, just as the school board did when they selected Dr. Polio, and just as Mayor Abramson did when he selected Chief White. And they get to ask questions and talk to those candidates. And I know that some candidates probably don't feel comfortable letting everyone know that they're looking for a new job. But if they want to come to Louisville, I think that they need to do that. Louisville's a great city, and it's an honor to be able to work and be the leader of our police department. The police chief being selected is the most important, in my opinion, appointment that the mayor makes. I told the mayor earlier that no planes were going to fly over while we were doing this, but the chief selection is the most important selection of the entire mayor's cabinet that I believe that the mayor makes, and I think it's very, very important that we all participate in that. And I think it's very important that we as a city recognize the things that are going on in our city right now. I know that we are going to shed some tears, and I know that we're going to have some hard conversations with one another as we go through this process. But in the end, we are Louisville, and Louisville has always survived. And Louisville will be better in the end for what we're going through right now. And we will look back on this time as a change in our direction of our city and a change in the direction of our country. And America will be better for all of this. Thank you, Mayor.
Chief Schroeder will now share some information. Chief.
Thank you, Mayor Fisher. I would like to take this opportunity to address a couple concerns we have heard from the community, from the media, and from the public at large. I'd like to discuss how and when we have used tear gas in deployments against protesting crowds. I want to assure those who have concerns about how we use our tactics that we do not take these concerns lightly and we do not use tear gas casually. Tear gas was only used as a last resort to clear crowds that were presenting a safety issue to the public. During the early days of the protest, we saw several people attending the protest bringing in weapons and other items into the event space with the intent of causing harm and destruction. This presented a danger both to the police officers and to the peaceful protesters who were attending these events. I know several peaceful protesters got caught up. I know several peaceful protesters got caught up in situations where tear gas had to be used, and I regret that those people had to experience that, had to go through the effects of tear gas. Our officers' intention is never to harm those who are doing the right thing, obeying the law, peacefully protesting, doing what we expect our citizens to do. Still, in response to the concerns we have heard from the community, I've implemented a new order where tear gas can only be used in future events by either my order or the order of my designee. Based on the concerns we've heard from the community, I think this will allow us to have the best possible response, protecting safety, while at the same time respecting the wishes of the community. We've also gotten several questions regarding the investigation that led up to the death of Breonna Taylor. One of the areas those questions revolve around is the seeking of the search warrant that led officers to Ms. Taylor's residence on March 13th. Questions have been raised by the Taylor family, their attorneys, the postal inspector, and others about how and why the search warrant was approved. As a result of those questions, I have placed Detective Joshua James, who applied for the warrant, on administrative reassignment until those questions can be answered. This matter has also been referred to the FBI. This is all part of the process of getting to the truth of what happened that night and leading up to that night. I recognize the process takes longer than we would all want, but it's what must be done to ensure a thorough and fair investigation for everybody involved and to ensure this community has the best trust available for this police department. Thank you.
All right, happy to take any questions. Say it again. Louisville needs to have a police department that is seen as a leader in the country in ethical policing. Louisville needs to have more resources, either indirectly or within the police department, for mental health services, social services, assistance with housing, so that all of the conditions that plague folks in low-income communities are addressed. That's one. Sorry about all the planes. But I don't believe the community of Louisville wants to defund the police. That's not our plan to do that either. It's to supplement the services they have. Police officers are asked to be mental health counselors. They're asked to be marriage counselors. They're asked to do way too many things that they're not trained to do. But we as a city need to make sure that those resources are available to LMPD or embedded within LMPD so people feel like whatever challenges that they have to deal with are being addressed effectively by the city. For the review itself, those will be in the responses, but I would imagine 2 to 3 months. I'm just guessing, but we'll share that with you as we get closer to that date.
And then in regards to the David McAtee investigation, more information came about yesterday from KSP and the FBI. Looking back, now that we know that the National Guard was the one who fired that fatal shot on Mr. McAtee, do you have any regret or second thoughts on asking the governor to bring the National Guard in?
Well, a lot of the issues are going to come out in the investigation. You know, I just want to remind people kind of what was taking place. The first night of the protest was Thursday. 7 people were shot from within the crowd. Fortunately, they all survived. The next night, Friday night, was the night where we saw the appearance of guys primarily dressed in black from head to toe that had their looting or their vandalizing bags, if you will. They were going around breaking windows and looting. So the tension from the first two nights of the protests were escalating very, very rapidly. And that's why Saturday morning a curfew was asked for. We asked for more assistance from the Guard. So all these things we're going to be able to look back at and see what mistakes were made. And that all led up to, some of that led up to, I'm sure, what took place at 26 and Broadway, which was another tragedy. Given the escalation and the violence and the potential for harm to people, we didn't know where it was going to be going. If it had continued on the escalation of Thursday and Friday night, with 7 people shot, with significant looting, you can replace stores, I get that, but 7 people shot, weapons coming into the crowd, we had to prepare for what we thought could be a worst case scenario.
Yes, ma'am. We have been made aware of it. We initiated a public integrity investigation. Our public integrity investigators are trying to reach out to those subjects who made those allegations, and I would certainly encourage them and any other person who thinks they may have been victimized to reach out to the public integrity unit. That's part of the overall investigation that we hope to determine. We don't have those answers yet. As you know, our public integrity unit is investigating that with the oversight of the Kentucky State Police. They're conducting literally hundreds of interviews. So we hope to get that information and make those determinations. And just so you understand how the process works, after the public integrity unit investigation is done, which addresses any potential criminal issues, then we will have a professional standards investigation, which is an entirely separate investigation to address any potential violations of policy. I couldn't hear your question. Well, again, that's part of our investigation. That's what we hope both our investigators and the Kentucky State Police investigators will be able to determine. That is something we don't know. I know they're doing some extensive reviews of the video to try and establish timelines. That's something we hope to get through the course of this investigation.
Is there any other audio or video of that?
I'm not aware of any right now, but currently Public Integrity is investigating with the Kentucky State Police. As they develop things, we will become aware of them. My commitment is to transparency, but I simply don't know right now.
So if there is more audio and visual material, will you?
It depends on the material. I probably would not release, you know, officer statements at this point, but if there's, you know, if we come across some video that I'm not aware of from, say, a citizen gives us some video that shows what happened, I would consider releasing that.
Well, the allegations are very troubling, and that's why it's important that they're looked into immediately, which has been the case. But, you know, these type of allegations erode police community trust, and they have always been taken seriously. They will be taken seriously. They're very disturbing. Yeah, the challenge to the city and to the country right now is that we've got, you know, we've got a coronavirus crisis going on, a pandemic. We've got an economic recession that we're battling right now. And then we're grappling with the fights for racial justice in our streets in terms of how to pull all of that together. And so you've seen many states right now where the coronavirus positives are starting to escalate. Our deaths here have been stable to down a little bit, but now the question is, what's going to be the impact of the virus based on all the folks out protesting? You know, a couple good things, it's outside, which we know the virus doesn't travel as well outside. A lot of the protesters are wearing masks as well, so that's good. We offered COVID-19 testing on Saturday and Sunday. Just a block away from Jefferson Square to make sure that the public health component was there as well. So we'll have to evaluate where we are as a community on that. But look, the need for people to get out and peacefully protest is important. So we're going to protect that with everything we can. Look, when I was elected for this job and swore the oath, I swore to do it during good times and bad times. And this is a challenge here in Louisville. It's a challenge all over the country right now. There's 150 cities that are going through this and 150 mayors as well. So when I ran for this office, I did it to address many of the issues that our marchers are calling for from the streets right now. We've worked on much of this throughout my mayoralty as well, as everybody knows. So what's important now in Louisville and cities all over America, there are plans to move forward. There are ways to do that to involve our citizens as well. In our case, it's building on the work that we have done to fight discrimination through Lean Into Louisville, to increase police community trust through the Synergy Project. And everybody just recognizes that this is very difficult work, and it is really unfortunate that America is in this place right now. But we've got to turn those feelings of despondency into action feelings. And our administration has been there. I continue to be there, as I said, fight for justice and fight for improvement, fight for dismantling systemic racism, ending poverty, police community reform, all the things I've been fighting for in the past, being fought for all over America, so I intend to do that with every fiber in my being. Okay. Yeah, Billy. Yeah, absolutely. On the budget, so the budget that we submitted to the Metro Council already has increases in it for opportunity youth. Those are at-risk youth, so the council is considering those right now. The biggest issue on the budget is whether or not there's going to be more direct relief coming from the federal government to make up for the decreases in revenue because of payroll taxes being down. So that has really whacked our budget in a super material way. We've been beseeching the U.S. Senate to get a bill passed so we can have some kind of visibility to that. Based on what they're saying, I I pray that it comes in July. They're going on recess at the end of July. If they don't come up with a solution, that's going to be a problem for us. In the meantime, what we're doing is using the rainy day fund to continue our budgeting all the way through that first month of July. Hopefully we'll have some visibility to that, but there's no question that that budget would include more investment in the type of services I talked about earlier, social services, health services, trauma-related services, housing services. Look, my dream is that everybody should have the basics here in America. They should have a living wage. They should have a roof. They should have adequate food. They should have health care and education. America calls herself the richest country in the world. We have the resources nationwide to provide that. But until our federal government sees that is the call from our citizens and does something about it, that's where the big money flows from, we're going to have a gap there. There are plenty of countries that have proven that you can have that, and we need that in America as well. We need that in our city.